Leave a like, comment, and subscribe, and hit that notification bell icon. It helps to promote the show. Hey guys, today we have 10 iOS coding tips for you for a better development experience.
Number one.
Typically, you would enable your breakpoints by just clicking on the line of code where you want the breakpoint. And to disable them, you would either drag them away like this or right-click and delete the breakpoint. But there's a handy keyboard shortcut that you can use. It's command backwards slash, and it will, where your cursor is placed, that's the line of code when you tap a command slash, that's where it will be enabled. So you can enable or disable or add or remove your breakpoints using that shortcut.
Number two.
There is a way to activate or deactivate your debug mode for Xcode to stop at the breakpoints you have set in your code base with this button over here, activate or deactivate breakpoints. And there's a command, there's also a menu option in the debug menu for it as well. But you could also use a keyboard shortcut for this. It's command Y, and it will do exactly the same thing. You see, it enables or disables the breakpoints in your code. So if you hit command R and run your code and you realize you don't want the breakpoints, you can quickly disable it while it's still compiling.
Number three.
Often when you're debugging your code base and need to print out an object that you have and you would like to know and examine the internal properties and the variables that it has, quite often you'll get, after you print the object, you'll get actually just the name of the class of that object. And you'll have to either somehow print individual properties, or if they're inaccessible private properties, you'll have to actually like breakpoint and debug and examine it that way. So there is a trick in iOS that you can do instead. What you can do is to use this dump method instead of print. As you can see, this dump method prints out the name of the class that we had, but also any values stored internally in its properties. But notice it does not print out the full name, which is a computed property. And a computed property is really a method, right? It just with a syntactic sugar of looking not like a property. So this computation might have side effects, and then the dump method does not run those, nor does it run any methods.
Number four.
So guys, sometimes happens that we misspell some words in our project while writing some code. Although it's not a big deal that we have some typos in our code, because our code will run logically fine. It will not be shown to the end users. But to maintain code base over the time, we should make sure that our code don't have many typos. Xcode has provided a tool called Spell Checker. So what you can do is you can go to Edit, and then go to Format, and then Spelling and Grammar, and then check this option, check spelling while typing. For example, I want to make a method name called something. Okay, so let's try to declare a method name called something. Okay, and I will intentionally miss one alphabet. So see, the Xcode has highlighted this, that I have missed something here, and I know what I missed. And now it's fine.
Number five.
Here are two handy keyboard shortcuts for you to travel and navigate your code easier. One of them is Option and left or right arrow. This allows you to travel between beginning or end of the word or jump to the next or previous word. And then if you have a very long method name or property name, a long word and camel cased word in your project, in your code, you can also travel between the cases, camel cases of the camel cased word with control left or right arrow. And both of those work equally with selecting. So if you hold Option Shift and then arrow keys, it will select or deselect in the direction you're going from the beginning and to the end of the word or vice versa. And then same goes for the camel case traveling. If you hold Control Shift, and then the direction, it will highlight or unhighlight that part of the camel cased word.
Number six.
Sometimes in our project, we get some error logs from Xcode that the project is unable to satisfy some constraints when we are using auto layout. But these constraints are hard to decipher, right? So we need a way to decipher them, right? So there is a handy tool for that. There is a website called wtflayout.com where you can just copy paste your error logs from the auto layout and then click on the go button. And when you click on the go button, it will do some calculations regarding what Xcode is trying to teach you about the constraints. So it says that the name label's height should be equal to 25, right? And the name label's height should also be at least 50. So now we can see that these two statements are conflicting. And this was the reason the Xcode was complaining about the constraints. So the solution is simple now. We just need to remove one of these constraints and our problem will be fixed.
Number 7.
Okay, guys. So now I want to declare closure. I want to take an int parameter, but I want to return a string. Let me figure it out how to do that. Is it? No. Wish I could have some handy tool for this as well. Okay, we have this website, closuresyntax.com. So here it actually shows you how to do that, how you can declare a variable, how to declare an optional variable, to type alias, constant, everything related to closure. Let me use this guy. Okay, so this guy is telling me to use like this, okay, to use the parameter types inside this and then declare the return type like this, okay. So here I go. I will declare the parameter type inside this braces and then here, and I will write equal to, okay. And okay, so this is done, but I'm still getting one error. Okay. So let me jump on to the implementation part. Here I can see I need to use an in keyword. Okay. Param in, and since I want to return something, so I will return a string. Finally, it worked thanks to this website. By the way, if you don't want to use this domain, you can use this domain as well to reach out to this site. costdownclosuresyntax.com.
Number 8.
One more thing. If you wonder about how to use that same thing in Objective-C. So in Objective-C, we have blocks, right? So we have a website with a similar domain, blocksyntax.com. And you can just reach out to this website and it will provide you a handy list of all the options to declare a variable or as a property or as a method parameter, everything about blocks in Objective-C.
Number 9.
Quite often when you work with data formatters, I don't know how about you guys, but I do forget the formatter's syntax. Like what is the actual, is this the day, right? And then is this the months, singular months, or is it the double M for triple M to display the full month's name? I never remember it. So if you also find yourself not being able to memorize this pattern and the syntax for date formatter, there's a handy website that you could use. It's called nsdateformatter.com. And will allow you to first play with your formatter, with your text, right? And put different variables here. And also it gives you the examples of how you can format things. So for example, if I would like to have the full months, I need the triple M for it, or the full year, the 4 Ys. Then for my use case, I probably want to have this 4 Ms over here. And then for the day, I would like to have the date and then the name of the day, or name of the week of that day.
Number 10.
And the last tip we have for you guys for today is to subscribe to Inside iOS Dev YouTube channel. Click subscribe button and hit that notification bell so that you never miss the next episode.
Subscribe and hit that notification button so you never miss the next episode.